Okay, so I would like to say something about myself, although something about me has already been said. So some of the slides will maybe go faster, right? Okay, so I'm the chair of the math department at Ohio State, so you already know that. I'm also originally from Mexico. Became a citizen in 2001, and this is my family. I'm married and have two daughters. I'm married for 28 years. One is a cellist, and the other one studied Slavic languages. I am a mathematician. I got a PhD from MIT, as well as I said already. My area of research is Lie groups and representation theory. And I cannot pass the opportunity to say how beautiful mathematics is. And I don't have time to explain that, but I'm going to flash a picture because I would like to show you just in a picture the beauty of mathematics. I like to teach, and when I teach, I give a warm-up exercise. So this is a warm-up exercise for you so you understand my picture. So this is a hexagon, right? But it's also a cube, right? You look at it, right? It's a cube. So what it is, it's a two-dimensional projection of a three-dimensional cube. And that's all you need to do to understand the next picture. That's the same kind of picture, but it's an eight-dimensional object now instead of a three-dimensional object that has been projected to two dimensions. It has 240 vertices, 30 in each of eight concentric circles. The corresponding eight-dimensional object, which is called a polytope, it's like a cube, you know, something with faces, was called V240 because it has 240 vertices in 1912, and was first discovered in 1900. It turns out that it describes the structure of one of these beautiful objects that we call Lie groups, something called a very exotic group called E8. Group is just some way of encoding symmetry, right? There's a lot of symmetry in nature, in physics it appears, in quantum mechanics is important. Okay, so that's all I'm going to do, but I'm going to come back to this picture. I like this picture for another reason, which is that you have all these points and there's all this interconnectivity between them. So I'll use that as an image later on. So I started my administrative career in 2005. And I was a vice chair in charge of the budget, promotion, tenure, and departmental staff. And we had an annual budget of $18 million, already was said, expenditures of $6 million in grants. Now, one thing that is important is that it's important for me. Dealing with budget has been one of my strengths, and it has really been useful when I became a chair, and I think it will be useful becoming a dean. At OSU, because of the size of our operation, the math department does have a lot of control. If you're large, you have lots of flexibility. If you have flexibility, you can make decisions about how to use your budget, right? Okay. So I became chair in 2010. In 2014, I was renewed for a second term. So now in my second term as chair. And I can say that I enjoy support of my department, even though I have introduced important changes. So one of the reasons that I'm here is that I really believe that there is a strong affinity between the things that I've been doing at Ohio State and the things that the university, Kansas University, University of Kansas, wants to do according to its strategic plan. I was really amazed at reading that. And I think that when I talked for the first time with the search committee, I made that point by kind of explaining the kind of things that are being done, that I've been doing, the changes that I have introduced by labeling them using the goals of the bold aspirations strategic plan, because they're really, things really match. And that's one of the reasons that I feel it would be natural for me to come here and continue doing things that I've been already doing. So these are the six goals of strategic plan of the University of Kansas, and I'll just kind of use them as labels. So in broad strokes, I'm proud of the following changes. I would like to say that being chair of the department, and some of you are chairs, some of you have been doing these kind of things, I cannot claim credit for anything without saying really that everything is, you're really working with others, right? It's really the work of others, and you just make things happen, or you create an environment in which things happen. So that's what I mean when I say introduce change. It's always other people working with you. So number one, the goal number one is to strengthen recruitment, teaching, and mentoring to prepare undergraduate students for lifelong learning, leadership, and success. So I think that since I became chair, then more emphasis has been given to the undergraduate mission of the math department at OSU, and I'm not going to now talk about that, but I would like to flash a picture just to kind of give you a flavor of the kind of things I've been doing, because this is relevant to some of the other things. So what this is a picture of a couple of articles that one of them is when our we developed a MOOC, and the MOOC went viral, and the person who developed it had an article featuring him in Forbes magazine. So the story there is that a lecturer came to me, Jim Fowler, and told me, I think in the fall of 2013, that he wanted to develop a MOOC for the fall of 2014. That's a short time, but I took a risk and I gave him resources. I gave him a TA to work with. It was his work, not my work. All I did is I empowered him to do what he wanted to do. And it turns out in a couple of months, we were surprised that he was teaching more people in that MOOC than the entire math department that OSU teaches in an entire year. You know, so it really caught the attention of the administration. By the way, so by now he has several MOOCs, and his numbers are in the, I think, hundreds of thousands. He became an assistant professor in our department, but more importantly, he kind of energized our gave a lot of energy to interest in calculus redesign, and my department is now involved in efforts to improve the teaching of calculus. Okay, so that's what I want to say about that. Number two, and some of these slides will go a little bit faster. The second goal, which is very important, is improvement of doctoral education. And I did introduce changes, again, working with others always, that improve the quality of the graduate program, and that's as measured by the PhD completion rate in math being doubled. We did that in conjunction with introducing four new master's programs that were more connected to needs of businesses, like an actuarial science program, or community, like math education masters. The last one is in one of them is in the last stages of approval. Third goal is enhancing research with emphasis upon areas of present and emerging strength. And here I'll just say that I developed one of the best interdisciplinary research groups in topological data analysis in the US. We joined positions in the College of Engineering. So this approached the chair of the College of Engineering, of the computer science, the chair of the Department of Computer Science, and we did this. I also developed an international partnership with, for example, with the University of Sao Paulo. So I'll just move on. But I also, so the goal number four has to do with engaging local, state, national, and global communities as partners in scholarly activities. And I developed a network of math department chairs of public institutions in the state of Ohio, collaborating with the Ohio Board of Regents. So this is something we did with the Ohio Board of Regents. And I just flashed the picture of all the universities and community colleges. We're talking about 3 dozen places. We have meetings twice a year at the math department, and it feels like a faculty meeting where we have, I don't know, 70 people usually around in the room where we have faculty meetings. We discuss things, we vote democratically. The Board of Regents, people from the Board of Regents are there, and some of these things, when they're approved, become rules that go to the entire state. So we have very good connection with the Board of Regents, and we have committees working on, for example, how to improve the success of students when they come for the first time in math, right? When they come for the first time to the university, gateway courses, things like that. So that's one more thing that is connected, I think, with one of the goals you have here in the University of Kansas. Increase the diversity of the faculty, so this is connected with recruiting value, develop and retain an excellent and diverse faculty and staff. I increase the diversity of the faculty and of the graduate program. One of those things that I did was I developed a summer program for underrepresented minorities. The name is SAMS, in partnership with the University of Puerto Rico at Mayagüez. This program just celebrated its fifth anniversary. And because of that, we have increased the number of students, underrepresented minorities, in our graduate program. And I just flash my picture from the last meeting where we celebrate, and the cake, right, in the summer. Okay, so that's one more thing we have been doing, And finally, I think I increased engagement. So the last one has to do with responsibly steward fiscal and physical resources, energize supporters to expand the resource base. So I have increased engagement with alumni, donors, in several departmental programs. And an example is, best example is perhaps our new master's program in actuarial science, which was developed in consultation with the leadership of important local insurance companies. Well, local means in the state of Ohio, because we have good relations with them, because some of the our alumni are working in some of those insurance companies. And I'll flash one more picture connected with community outreach. This is what is called the STEAM Factory. So the STEAM Factory is the following. A faculty member that, in the department was a junior faculty member when I started as chair, first developed a network of faculty members. It was a network of junior faculty members, assistant professors. It was a social network. It was online also. But it soon became a group that wanted to encourage collaboration, interdisciplinary collaboration. And eventually got funding from the university. It's housed administratively in the department, in the sense that we have a couple of staff members that are part of the math department. The chair of the committee of the STEAM Factory is a member of the department. Who started it. STEAM, of course, stands for STEM plus A for the arts, right? So it's really an interdisciplinary group. And what they do is they have a colloquia in which they choose a topic, like an example with movement. And then a person from the dance department may be the person who talks about movement, but then maybe somebody from physics does that. So they have this idea, they have this collaborative, they want to promote collaboration, and they do that. But they also have outreach, community outreach, and that's what the picture is. All of these are members of the department presenting at the place downtown, near downtown Columbus, where there is a kind of farmer's market. Okay, so now really I would like to move to the topic of the presentation, and I kind of refer to some of the things that I have said. So 21st century challenges to colleges of liberal arts and sciences. This is, of course, based on my experience as chair at Ohio State University, conversation with several deans of colleges of liberal arts and sciences from different public universities, and there are articles that you can find, of course, in the media, right? And just to put it in a nutshell, I think that there is a sense of a loss of relevance of several disciplines in colleges of liberal arts and sciences. And this is manifested as lost ground with respect to other colleges, when you compare what's happening to other colleges, in terms of the percentage, so I think some people call this market share, of credit hours, majors, and ultimately funding, right? An institution grows, but if college grows less, or maybe it decreases, but somehow there is a bigger decrease in the College of Arts and Sciences, or liberal arts. The challenge, of course, is regaining the lost ground, and I'm going to elaborate on this. And actually, so tackling this issue, I think, just to give a quick summary of what I think I'm going to end up saying in the end, tackling this issue involves being a participant in addressing the big issues of our times and engaging the local community, the state, and the world. Moreover, taking a new look at majors offered by the College of Arts and Sciences or Liberal Arts and Sciences, to making these programs a good preparation for employment and future leadership. I think leadership is a word that appears in the mission of the university, and I saw it everywhere when it comes to undergraduates. That's we would like them to be leaders, and I'll come back to that. So I actually identified five challenges, and what I have described really is challenge number one, the perceived loss of relevance in the 21st century, I'll just call it. There's a second one, which is being an adequate reflection of a 21st century world, which, as we know, is more interconnected and overflowing with data, right? So I'm just going to say that like that. And I would like to represent that world by my picture. You have all these dots and all these interconnections. Okay, so that's just because I like this picture, I would like to show it to you many times. Yeah, okay. So number three is on the representation of women and minorities in the faculty and student body. And as we know, in some departments, for example, women are really underrepresented. And this is the case, for example, in math departments all over the country, and so on and so forth, right? So I will talk about that a little bit more. How to teach and how to learn the 21st century. So there are all sorts of discussions, how should we be teaching? There are online courses, there are MOOCs now, right? There is active learning, so that's another challenge that we have. And then having to do more with less, that's happening more and more, again, all over the country, not just in one place. Sometimes, in the case of research funding, there's a decrease of federal funding to many STEM fields, for example. So that's a challenge too, connected with having to do more with less. Okay. So let me first focus on the issue of perceived loss of relevance, challenge number one. And I start by considering just showing you some data that just comes from the website of the University of Kansas. So the first thing I did, I went to University of Kansas. It turns out that there's a lot of data there, and you really get a good picture of what's going on by just going to the website. So I made a little graph. It's a pie chart, right? So this pie chart shows you the credit hours by schools, the college, and colleges. I think at Ohio State, they would be colleges, right? Here, the schools and colleges. So there are different units here, and it doesn't really matter too much which is which. What is clear is that the red one is the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences. And what I have done here is indicated the piece that is missing when you move up to 2015, right? So that's what has happened. Right? And this, remember, is not, this is percentages, of course. This is a piece of the pie. Okay, so that's the same chart just showing you instead the losses and gains percentage-wise. This is the, again, let me call it market share because that's what it's called in some similar graph at Ohio State. So University of Kansas, loss of market share of credit hours in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences in a four-year period, or from 2011-12 to 2014-15. Okay, that's, let me move to OSU, right? Because in some sense, I'm going to treat OSU as a kind of a typical place. You know, I think, something expected. Well, this graph, I didn't make that graph. That graph I got from Ohio State University somewhere, the website. So that's the same graph as the last one, credit hours by colleges. And I cannot really tell you which of those names correspond to what college. I know one, I can recognize business, but I don't remember. I know that, what I know is that this one here is engineering, and you had also engineering on this side in the other slide for University of Kansas, and I know what the other one over there is. That's the College of Arts and Sciences, right? So it's kind of the same picture. You have engineering going up, you have College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, or Arts and Sciences, going down in the share of credit hours. So that's what we're talking about in concrete terms. I didn't have a similar information about majors, but this is the similar graph, but now majors. This is what has happened, right? In the same period of time, engineering majors at Ohio State have grown. Engineering majors from the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences have declined. The same picture. I feel that there's not just an affinity of things that I'm doing over there that are done here. There's also the same problem. I have been dealing with this problem there, and I think, you know, let me call it a challenge. There's a challenge over there that is replicated here. It's a challenge at the University of Kansas, the same way as it's the challenge at Ohio State University, right? okay, in the case of Ohio State, this happened a short amount of time, so they're actually national news. Inside Higher Education has an article about deficits of the College of Arts and Sciences at Ohio State, and I think Indiana Bloomington. It features two departments. So it was big enough to do that. Some quotes, enrollments. So I'm just instead of giving you my opinion, this is what the article says. Enrollments in departments like English and History, which historically have been staples of humanities programs, are down nationally. Okay, maybe we knew that all along, but the article says that, right? Ohio State University's College of Arts and Sciences faces a $10 million deficit, a shortfall of about 4% of its $266 million operating budget. Administrators blame trends in enrollment. So that's part of the article again. Well, 2013, there's an article about Harvard. Humanities fall from favor, right? So that's what we're talking about. So to address the challenge number one in the context of University of Kansas, one needs to consider how to be relevant. I think how to make the college be relevant, be perceived as relevant, and then try to regain lost ground as much as possible, right? Credit hours, majors. For example, majors seem to be the key to this. Not losing majors or regaining majors by creating more interesting, exciting majors that are attractive. Okay, so this is what I think is a sketch of the solution. So there is no silver bullet, but this is what I think should be happening at University of Kansas. One of them is that the college should be seen as participating in the solution of problems of our time. That's very vague, very abstract, very general, but it means something. For example, so I'm not the one to tell you what are the problems of our times. There are many problems. But you already had at the University of Kansas a process by which you picked a few things. There are these initiatives that are here, sustaining the planet, powering the world, promoting well-being, finding cures, building communities, expanding opportunities, harnessing information, multiplying knowledge. And you can, there are all these details in the Bold Aspirations strategic plan. So, okay, we can start there. But essentially the point is we know that the College of Liberal Arts has to be relevant by tackling problems that are important in our time. And there are many types of problems, STEM fields, and there are humanities, and so on and so forth. These are the ones that have been selected at the University of Kansas as important. Enthusiastically working with those is a good thing to do. But in addition to that, engage other institutions, local businesses, border regions, alumni, institutions at other states, international institutions. That has to do with not just doing that, but also being seen as being relevant by, for example, collaborating with the Board of Regents, which is the kind of thing I mentioned at the state of in Ohio State, with the state of Ohio, working with alumni from the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences, who are in businesses, and making them a part of your, asking them for their opinion, for their advice when you create a new program, and somehow getting their support when you need that support, right? So that's important. And also you want to be internationally known, internationally relevant, having international partnerships, not just study abroad programs, but actual research partnerships with other universities. And that can only be done department by department. Departments have the contacts, faculty have the contacts, and the college should help promote those partnerships, sometimes with funds if that's possible. So the college should have a role in helping those international connections. Develop interdisciplinary undergraduate majors in the College of Liberal Arts and Sciences that better fit the demands of the job market. Okay, we also want to make our majors more relevant, more attractive, and get more of those in the college, right? And then I will give an example. And I think I talked about this example with several people in the audience already, so bear with me. To give an example of an interdisciplinary program that one may explore, I'll start by asking what would benefit graduating students. And the graduating students that I know are the ones from my department. So I'm just going to give you that as an example So I'll start by talking about my graduating majors and showing you a graph of an exit survey of graduating majors at Ohio State in math, right? So what is interesting about this graph, and I think there are similar graphs in many departments, maybe in the math department here, is that while some people, so I think that, let me just point to some things. This is, there's some students go to some professional grad school. That can be law school, but it can also be some financial engineering. So that's what this is. This is PhDs in math, masters in math. This is what mathematicians think they're teaching when they're teaching majors sometimes, right? It's a very small fraction. Then the other STEM grad schools, some people have become physicists or become something else. So some other STEM grad school. But majority of the students are people that most members of the math department don't recognize as mathematicians, but they are our majors. So 62% become K-12 teachers or get some random job right after college that has nothing to do with math. Insurance company, they go to banks. So essentially, these are people that are just OSU majors in our case that have enhanced mathematical skills because they have been taking math courses. They're not mathematicians, really, but because they have enhanced math skills, they are hired by employers like them, right? So the main point I want to make here is that, so this is maybe the point already made. The point is that, so we talked about leadership. You want these students to move up. You don't want them to be just nerds in some corner doing the hard work in some office. You want them to move up also. And the ones that move up that do well in the job market are the ones that also have, so first I'll refer to this as writing skills, right? Because I don't really want to talk about skills. I believe that what matters is that they have critical thinking, which is more than just mathematical critical thinking, that involves the critical thinking that you find in the humanities, right? So that's what I want to mention here. And that's the connection that I want to make with between STEM fields and humanities, okay? So, okay, let me now move on to what has happened at Ohio State, because I want to make this an example of something that can be explored at the University of Kansas. At Ohio State, the math department and the English department are currently in the process of creating an integrated math and English major. That means that we are in conversations with the chair of the English department. We already have progress. We have already an idea of what will be taught in every semester and so on and so forth, right? Okay. The joint degree will emphasize different forms of rigorous thinking. That's what I said. Right? What I would like is that this is about thinking in different ways. That's the emphasis in not just skills. We're not just talking. Writing skills are important. We want something else. We want something serious from the humanities. Well, there's this article from Forbes that actually says that this is not bad. This article from Forbes magazine says that, in fact, cutting-edge tech companies actually are interested in exactly that kind of majors that have some kind of tech skill, math skill, for example, and are also good in art or in some humanities major area. And okay, that's the hottest ticket. And I'll just quote briefly, this is from Forbes, narrowly defined tech jobs by themselves aren't going to be the answer for long-term employment growth. Says Michael, well, doesn't matter. Engineers may still command the biggest salaries, but at disruptive companies such as Facebook, Uber, the war for talent has moved to non-technical jobs, right? Okay, so that's what, and it turns out that Stanford has started a degree like this in 2014 involving computer science and English. Actually, this was my motivation. It was a model because we had something to work on, except that instead of computer science, we work with math. With different types of math, there, you know, you may have concentration in financial mathematics and actuarial science, concentration on education, for example. So we came up with several possibilities, and that's what we're working on. This is not yet approved. This is in the works. Right? This is something that we're talking with the chair of the English department and collaborating with the STEAM Factory. Right? STEAM Factory, remember, is exactly this interdisciplinary group. They're very happy to help us because that's part of their mission to create interdisciplinary programs. So they're also partners with us. Okay, so I will I the proposal would be to have, well, to have similar things happen at the University of Kansas, explore things like this between different STEM departments and humanities. Challenge number two was to be an adequate reflection of a 21st century world, which is interconnected and overflowing with data. And I use this picture once more because I like it. And that means to deal with this challenge, challenge number two at the University of Kansas, place more emphasis on interdisciplinarity. Maybe that's already happening. I'm sure it's already happening, but I think it continues to be important. Interconnection between programs, and that's what I've been talking about, but also the level of research, right? At the level of research, introduce integrated undergraduate programs. That's exactly what I talked about in challenge number one. Support and promote joint faculty positions and joint programs. But nevertheless, I would like to say that existing programs that are standalone programs should always be promoted and supported, because you have to build on what you already have, which is strong, right? So, and that's very important. And I am all the time doing that, making that argument as chair of the math department. We want interdisciplinary positions, but we also have this topology program or this number theory program that needs support when people retire, because it's already a strong program and you cannot do without. You know, it's attracting graduate students. So that's the other part. There's a tension between the two things: support interdisciplinarity and support existing strong programs as much as possible. And there is no formula for resolving that. But I would like to say that I have sympathy for those two things, right? And I have strong sympathy also for supporting programs that are standalone, that have tradition in one place, and that are successful already. So strengthen data analysis. That's simply connected with the fact that data is important in the 21st century. We're overflowing with it. It's increasingly needed across many disciplines, so it's not just STEM fields. Rely on data to make important decisions. That's maybe the kind of thing I like to do. I like to rely on data to make decisions. Data as the start of a conversation with somebody, with a chair, for example, or with my dean, right? Right now, I go with my dean and this is my data, and that's the start of a conversation, not the end of a conversation. So, but data is very important. Take into account data. Then challenge number three was on the representation of certain groups in the faculty and student body of many departments. Okay, so I already said a few things that I have done at Ohio State. So to promote diversity at the college at the University of Kansas, I believe that the college should make faculty positions available outside the regular approved positions all the time for partner accommodations and for special opportunities with underrepresented minorities. That's what has worked at Ohio State in my department, for example, that we have had a college that has been very accommodating, very willing to give us a position when we have an opportunity. And then what we have done is we have looked for those opportunities beyond our approved positions. So basically it's very hard to, for example, to increase the number of women in the math department without also looking at partner accommodations, spousal accommodations. If you do that, then you just will not be successful. I think that maybe this is something common at the University of Kansas and Ohio State. Usually this is a great opportunity, a great way of bringing talent to the university, right? Bringing a couple when it's possible to do that, okay? And the same thing applies for underrepresented minorities. Developing general programs, and this depends on the department. This goes department by department, what people like to do, but I would say that if you want to bring underrepresented minorities to your department, then you have to bring them to campus and make them feel good. So have a program that does that. And if it is possible, ideally you do that by working with some other institution that serves underrepresented minorities as a partner, right? So that's not a recipe, but in general, I think that works. Challenge number four, how to teach and how to learn in the 21st century. And that to do with active learning, online courses, MOOCs, etc. And here, first of all, I would like to say that one of the things that I'm impressed with, one of the things that the University of Kansas is already doing very well, helping undergraduate students, for example, or graduate students. I was impressed that University of Kansas was featured among 20 what they call deep institutions, and I always forget what deep stands for, but it's something like documenting effective educational practice, I think. So I looked at this book that features Kansas, University of Kansas, as an example. The important thing is that they pick 20 institutions that are effective in their undergraduate programs, create an effective learning environment for students to succeed in their college careers, and I saw that the University of Kansas was one of three flagship state universities. Another one of the three was in Michigan, so really good company. Right? So it's really, to me, that was really impressive. So lots of things are already being done very well. So I would continue to promote active learning at the and undergraduate research. Ideally, there should be an environment of experimentation. I think that's what I like. What is important is really to create an environment in which people are trying things, right, in an intelligent way. And for example, bringing to town, bringing to the campus experts to tell them the best practice, what they're doing somewhere else, and learning from them, right? So that's, I think, very important. Continue creating online courses. I had conversations with Paul Ashley about online courses. I think this may be a way to bring revenue to the university, but also maybe it helps many students to have access. In the case of the math department at Ohio State, for example, this gives access. We have some online courses in which calculus, in which we manage to get some students somewhere in the state of Ohio who are in high school and want to take a course at Ohio State. So it provides access to many people. And then promoting undergraduate research, I'll just say that one needs to acknowledge faculty efforts in faculty compensation process. Right? It's very important that that's acknowledged to be able to get people to do that. Okay, so one of the parts of dealing with the challenge number four was at the University of Kansas was graduate education and increase the quality of the graduate program. That was one of the goals in the strategic plan. What I've been talking about with several people and thinking about is that to improve the graduate rankings, the quality of the graduate program, which will translate into graduate rankings, it is very important actually to make a selection, because you cannot spread thin your funds. So it's very important that there is a way to select departments that are on the verge of moving up in the rankings to the right place. Or maybe there are departments that are central to the university that they just have to be improved because they're important for the rankings of the university, not just of the college or of the particular department. Right? So the idea would be to develop departmental plans with the aim of investing in a selected group of departments which are ready and have a good plan to move up in the graduate rankings. I think that's important to do, to be selected with the idea that you then maybe select a few departments in a few years. And the way I see it is, when there are good times, then these are the departments that you invest in. When in bad times, these are the departments that you protect, right? And this is the way we have the approach that we have, for example, at Ohio State in budget times. There are certain parts of our operation that are like the gems of our department, right? That we know that we want to protect. We protect them at budget time, but there has to be agreement about what those are, right? And then invest in those when it's time to invest, and so on. But so that's one thing that I think is important. Introduce new interdisciplinary programs, and if appropriate, reduce the size of existing programs. I think I'll just mention the example of Ohio State as a kind of idea that sometimes that's what works. You reduce the size of the PhD program, and and you can improve its quality by you end up doubling the. So I will come back to that. Actually, maybe it will be the next. So I will now expand on that. So how can you improve the quality of a PhD program? And I will basically talk a little bit more about my experience at Ohio State by just giving you a couple of graphs. And so this is the 3-year averages of the numbers of graduating students in math at OSU, right? So every dot there is really 3 years. And that's what has happened. So basically, for a long time, we were graduating something below 10 students a year, PhD. And it's now frequently 20 students. So let me give you a little bit the story behind this. So somewhere around here, 2008, I was vice chair. And there were budgetary problems. And I led a small group of faculty. Well, maybe I should say I was part of a small group of faculty that made a bold proposal to the dean, to the department, and to the provost to reduce the size of the PhD program and introduce additional master's programs. So these are the master's programs that I talked about before. So that was done in 2008. I became chair 2 years later, and in a sense, I've been implementing all of this proposal. Part of the proposal involved improving on the graduate education, improving the support in the graduate program internally. It's not just about decreasing size to improve quality, right? Decreasing size to improve quality means you get better students, but that's not the only thing, okay? And this is just indicating that it's 223% when you compare the 3-year average of, I think, 2015 with 2015 and 2002, okay? 3-year averages. But you have to remember that we also decreased the number of entering students. So it's actually more than twice improvement. Maybe I'll say a little bit more for this. What was important is that there was also a change in the environment in the department, and there were several things that were just policies that were introduced. And maybe that will come later. So maybe I'll come back to this. So this again, doing more with less, because in fact, almost every second year we had a budget cut, so we didn't get more funds to do this. This was done without getting more funds. It just happened, right? With the same funding or with less funding, we doubled the PhD completion rate. Some departmental policies that may have helped. So it's not just about getting a smaller PhD program. Changes were introduced to the faculty teaching load policy, okay, and to the faculty salary process. So that in the teaching load policy, mentoring graduate students is recognized as a form of teaching. Okay? In the math department, that's important. So that means that if you have graduate students, then you teach less. That's all it means, right? Meeting expectations in teaching and service requires significant involvement in the graduate and undergraduate program beyond classroom teaching. So the following paragraph was inserted in the governance document of the department. I'll just read it. To meet expectations in teaching and service, a faculty member should have significant involvement in either the graduate program or the math undergraduate program. Involvement in these two programs as aspects that should be regarded as contributions to teaching, and so on and so forth. Okay, the main thing is teaching and service at salary time roughly count as 50%, or they contribute as 50% to some score that gives you your salary, right? And to meet expectations, you should be involved with a graduate program, mentoring graduate students, or if you don't want to do that, at least be mentoring undergraduate students at the level of undergraduate research. So that's what we did. And that simply made it easier for us to find mentors for students. For example, we have new master's programs. How do we know that faculty are going to mentor them, right? So that helped with that. Okay. And one more thing, I'll just show you the 3-year averages of number of graduate fellowships given to incoming students. It doubled in a period of 5 years, I think, 2015 to 10, 218%. So that's really hard work, you know, to get more fellowships from the graduate school It means you have, there's a lot of paperwork, you have to document, there's a lot of things to document, and you don't know if the student is going to come to your department. So that's hard work from our recruitment committee, graduate recruitment committee. So all of that is simply work to improve the graduate program internally, paying more attention to the graduate program in addition to reducing the size, which by itself maybe wouldn't have been important, sufficient. Okay. Challenge number five is challenge having to do more with less, addressing the decrease of federal funding, for example. And here I just want to point out some, I went to the website of NSF, so you can find at NSF for every year the total amount of funding for any university, University of Kansas, MPS, Mathematical and Physical Sciences, or Biological Sciences, Bio, and you can add them together, basically your STEM, some STEM fields. And so these are the numbers from the NSF website. You then, I then converted them to constant dollars, and I found like 27% decrease in the, this is awarding 1 year compared to awards in the other year, okay. Now, when you do the same thing for OSU, you find a 21% decrease. So it seems like it's probably a national trend. It happened to everybody, right? But that's a problem because you want to improve the quality of graduate programs, you want to improve research, and some of that research requires funding. So this is actually a problem, not just for University of Kansas, but also, of course, for Ohio State, for everybody, right? The decrease in federal funding. And again, there's no silver bullet to solve that problem, but one can start by mentoring junior faculty. This will connect with the challenge number five, faculty productivity. I will connect this with faculty productivity and connected with external grants. I think junior faculty should be mentored, first of all the way to the rank of professor. But what I really wanted to say is that one should promote an environment in the college in which faculty routinely submit proposals for external grants. Maybe it's already happening, and then one should just make sure that the college promotes this. But this includes also infrastructure grants. I mean, I have done some of those in my department. It's a lot of work, it's teamwork. Several faculty members have to get together, write a proposal, and it's possible they don't get the funding, right? So it's really difficult to do this, but that's the kind of thing that you have to do to improve NSF funding or external funding at the University of Kansas. And also maybe have workshops for junior faculty involving faculty that have been successful getting grants. For example, workshop for faculty to get a career award, NSF career award, that helps. I think junior faculty are very happy to hear about these things. One possibility is I'm just saying things that could be explored, right? None of these things are set in stone by me, in any way. It's not, everything is something that can be explored. The College of Liberal Arts and Science could consider faculty stimulus program. One possibility is selecting investment in faculty members who are research active, not achieving their potential, and need some help to get external funding. So we tried that, at least in the math department, Ohio State. We have a locally funded research institute, funded by funds of the math department, and we decided to have a stimulus program that ran 2 to 3 years. It involved some faculty members on the regional campuses, and I think out of 20, maybe 4 were successful in getting a grant. Okay, so there is some kind of commitment from the faculty member that he or she is going to do certain things, but then there's some funds to travel to conferences, some help, right? So that's what we did, and this is not necessarily something something that can be explored. Another possibility is, the second point, maybe it's more controversial, but I'll just say it because it's something that we did in the math department and has been done in the College of Arts and Science at Ohio State, which is to consider alternative paths to promotion. So that depends on whether this is the right thing to do here or not. At Ohio State, it was. There are lots of people that were associate professors for a long time, but they were at the same time involved in very important things involving teaching and service, for example, developing an actual science program, things like that. And the alternative plan for promotion to the rank of professor based on documentable distinguished teaching or distinguished service. So the point is that one can document that. And this may not be the right thing for University of Kansas. I think I've talked to several people in my visit and I didn't get a good reception. So I'm just throwing it out there because we did that and I didn't erase it from my presentation. But you know, that's a possibility always, being flexible. And always bring distinguished scholars to campus for short-term or long-term visits. I think that, so again, well, I think the college is in a position to help doing that, and maybe it's already happening, but making sure that distinguished people come to campus and that help energize the research environment. Okay, so there's also the administrative part, and I just basically like to say a little bit about decision making and so streamline decision making and make the college more efficient. I like that decisions that need to be quick are made fast by the people who can make those decisions. That we make things happen when they need to be quickened, and that happens a lot when you're hiring faculty. Right? Sometimes we don't have all the information, but I think that the college should be responsive to needs, especially when things are when time is important. But especially, I would like to promote or create an environment and conditions in which chairs, associate deans, staff in leadership positions make their own decisions with their own area of responsibility. And I think I talked a little bit about that with several people here, and I got the sense that more or less that's what's already happening at the college. So I like that in that case, right? I'm not a micromanager. I like to work with people that I trust and that make their own decisions with some kind of oversight, appropriate oversight, but it's not, I don't like to tell people what to do, right? I think people are more enthusiastic doing the job when they have the ultimate say. And so that's my attitude towards chairs, towards associate deans that would work for me as dean, right? And that's my attitude at Ohio State. And this is general attitude, I think. I detest bureaucracy. I think the attitude of the administrative staff in the college should be always of trying the best to say yes to a request that is enthusiastic, that is well-reasoned. And sometimes then one has to say no, but I think people understand when they listen, when someone listens carefully, tries very hard to say yes, and then it's not possible. I think that's very important. It's easy to take no when someone really, you feel that somebody has listened to you and try very hard to make it possible. Okay, so that's, finally I would like to say that, maybe it's repeating this, that I was pleased to find out that there is in fact a strong affinity between the things that I have been doing at Ohio State and the strategic plan that I found of the University of Kansas at college. Certainly I would be enthusiastic and proud to join a college like the College of Liberal Arts, University of Kansas. And I will end now my presentation.
So we've just been talking about time and we're sort of at the end of our time, but we want to give people a chance to ask some questions. So we'll have about 10 minutes or so for that.
Yeah. Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
In one of your last slides, you mentioned that you're not a micromanager and right. You trust the departments to do their thing. Would you envision still situation when, as a dean, you will have to intervene?
Yes, I do.
Right.
I trust people that. So there are people that I trust and people that I don't trust, right? There are people that require that you manage more carefully. I like to work with people that I trust, but then when I like that people that are working for me feel free to make decisions, talking to me. And so here's what happens. I don't like to tell people what to do, but I like to discuss with people, bounce ideas, and I think I'm very persuasive and I can convince people of the right course of action. And I'm really talking about vice chairs or associate deans, just the usually people that directly would work for me, right?
So is there a situation you would intervene in departmental matters?
In departmental matters. I don't like to intervene in departmental matters. I think the role of the dean is to set some kind of general policy. And unless there's a request for help from the chair of the department, I don't believe in intervening in departmental matters. I think the faculty usually are in the position to make decisions on their own with the chair, right? But I understand that sometimes a chair can request help from the college to intervene, and then I think it makes sense to intervene.
Wondering if I could go back to what you were describing, you're working on that's in process at your institution with the joint majors that bring together humanities and STEM disciplines. And I wonder if you could say a little bit about the organizational and practical obstacles to creating those kinds of programs and how you might overcome them.
Yeah, so I was impressed that we didn't run into any obstacles. Essentially, I went to talk to the chair of the English department. She was very enthusiastic. She brought some counselors. Everybody that we talked to so far has been very supportive. Then we work with the STEAM Factory. So it has been moving along very fast. I understand that there is an advisory board. There's an advisory board of the college. And apparently they will be supportive of this kind of project. So. Right now, of course, there is a process. It has to be reviewed. We have done these kind of things before. We have not this math plus English, of course, but we have introduced four master's programs. So there is a process of approval. But I expect that it will just move along very well because I see support from every corner. People are very enthusiastic. So there are other programs that have been difficult to explain to people. This has not been one of those. People have.
Maybe just quickly taking it from the from a slightly different angle.
Yeah.
What about the situation where, I mean, do you expect, I should put it that way, to have enough students with the necessary background? I mean, I ask this because I know that it can be a problem bringing together computer science and humanities because of the math requirements.
Right. Okay. So until we start running that major, then we will know how many really students we can get. What I know is that about 2/3 of our graduating majors in principle would benefit. So what the challenge is really to orientation time in the first year to bring the message to the students, there is this possibility available and it's great, you know, and then recruit students. So that would be the challenge. But it's in principle, 2/3 of our students, you know, we have 1,200 students, something like 700 students over in our department could potentially benefit from this. It doesn't mean that we have 700 students, but we have a large pool of students that from where if even 10% enter the major, we have already very good numbers, right? And in the English department, I'm assured that there are many people that would like to do this and are in situation of doing this. So I think, maybe I mentioned this already, but what I was told by the chair of the English department is that many of their entering majors do have lots of math abilities, and they just drop math because they start taking English, but they could continue taking math as well. And that she's thinking that one could convince some of those students that it's good for them in terms of employment, for example, to pursue something like this. Right? So only once we started, we will know exactly. But I expect that it has a potential for lots of numbers because just looking at the potential majors in math that could be interested in this.
Interdisciplinary front is it's very hard for faculty, for junior faculty, to be involved in interdisciplinary work when they have the specter of promotion and tenure process ahead of them. And it's one thing to say that the college will support them through that process, but they have to go through another step as well at the university.
You mean if you hire somebody in two departments?
Well, especially joint positions.
Right. So we have several joint positions like that. And I don't know how it works here, but the way we have done it at Ohio State University is that we have the person has tenure only in one department. So the promotion tenure really happens in one department, and sometimes it's the math department, in our case, sometimes it's the other department. And that has worked well. We haven't had any problems. It usually is a friendly discussion with the chair, sometimes at salary time, right? What you propose to you. It hasn't really been a difficult thing to do. That's what is amazing. So, especially because we handle the tenure only in one place. We haven't had a problem case, and you usually hire people that look like they're going to be successful, and they are, right? So I think a challenge, actually, a challenge is mentoring, right? Because you have, I think at least we have a faculty member that has a lab in a biological sciences department and has an appointment in math, the tenure is in the math department, and then the challenge is always mentoring that person from the two sides, but I think things are working.